Madam Speaker.
Madam Speaker.
Honourable Scott Simpson.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. If there was ever an example of this new government's lack of readiness and preparedness to be in government, it's that minister that has just resumed his seat. About 3 months ago, he had no expectation at all that he would be in the hot seat, and his speech and contribution to this address and reply debate absolutely sealed the confirmation of that very firmly in the minds of everyone who would have been listening and everybody in the chamber today. Madam Speaker, it's a pleasure to be participating here in the address and reply debate, and it's with pleasure that I congratulate you on your appointment as the presiding officer of this House, and to your colleagues as other presiding officers, I wish you collectively well in this 52nd Parliament. I have the great pleasure and very proudly the responsibility of returning to this House for a third term as the very proud and keenly championing MP for Coromandel. And I'm pleased to report, Madam Speaker, that the pahutukawa are in bloom along the Thames coast and around the peninsula, and that summer is on its way. And we are going to enjoy, notwithstanding this new government, a very good summer in the Coromandel. The election result was interesting in Coromandel because we had some good candidates, I have to say, and I wanted to congratulate the other candidates who went through the campaign with me in Coromandel. We had a new Green candidate, and he took over from the irrepressible Catherine Delahunty, who's retired from this House. He did pretty well. In my view, made something of a rookie's mistake and ran a candidate campaign rather than a party vote campaign, which saw the Green Party vote diminish significantly in the Coromandel, a seat once held by a Green MP. And that was probably a surprise, although part of it was probably in response to the situation that occurred during the election campaign, where the former Green Party leader, Materia Ture, was forced to acknowledge that her electoral and benefit fraud meant that she needed to go from this place. And what I'm sad about as a result of that, Madam Speaker, is that two other, I think, good Green MPs are not sitting in this chamber, Kennedy Graham and Dave Clendon. And in what I think was probably one of the most principled acts that I'd seen in my years of watching politics in New Zealand, Kennedy Graham and David Clendon chose to resign their places on the Green Party list as a matter of principle. This House is the poorer for not having those two Green members here. I worked with Kennedy Graham on the Globe New Zealand project, which led to the Vivid report. And I've got to say that I worked very closely and well with Kennedy Graham because that was truly a cross-party consensus document. And I hope that when the climate change initiatives that this government has heralded so loudly do come into effect, I hope that they find a place for Kennedy Graham and Dave Clendon because they are two MPs who did make a good contribution into this House. I want to congratulate my colleagues in the National Party, and particularly our leader Bill English, for what I thought was an excellent campaign. Bill English came to the Coromandel and campaigned through there with me. I have very fond memories of standing in front of him, in front of the world famous lemon and pyro bottle in Pyra, and we had a very good period of time campaigning there. But what was immediately apparent when we had Bill English in the electorate was that how he was speaking to middle New Zealand in a way that resonated, that captured their imagination, in a way that worked for them. It was aspirational, it was standing on the very good record of the 9 years that the National Party had had in government, and we've left this government with a New Zealand that is in very good shape. And no matter what they will try and do in terms of rewriting history and trying to change the facts and the numbers and statistics, the simple reality is that New Zealand had done well and prospered under 9 years of stable, calm, rational leadership of John Key and Bill English. And so where are we now? Well, we find ourselves now with a new government, ill-prepared for government, ill-prepared for leadership, and ill-prepared for the challenges and the opportunities that actually they confront and face on the Treasury benches. And funnily enough, I was speaking to a New Zealand First candidate only last week who said, well, he said, I dodged a bullet. He said, that's about himself. He said, I didn't get elected, I dodged a bullet, because I would not have wanted to be there in hindsight, because I didn't think for one moment, said this New Zealand First candidate, that the Right Honourable Winston Peters would do what he did. Now, that be as it may, I suspect it probably reflects what could easily be referred to as voters' remorse by a fair percentage of New Zealand First voters who actually didn't vote for this outcome, weren't expecting it and weren't wanting it. And so in my electorate, where there were some New Zealand First voters, I'm pleased to say that my National Party membership numbers have increased a wee bit. There are a number of them that have come back to the mothership, so to speak, and they are in good heart and they're ready for the next election in 2020. Madam Speaker, Bill English has given me a great opportunity to take over the National Party's spokespersonship role on environment. And I'm delighted to have been given that opportunity because being from the Coromandel and representing the electorate, of course, our natural environment and our natural heritage and resources are incredibly important to me, my constituents and the rest of the nation. And in the National Party, I think we've got a very good view about environmental care, responsibility and management. But we have never talked up our goals and aspirations and our good intent in the way that this government did during the election campaign. And they really did talk it up. And so Bill English, in his address and reply when leading off this debate a week or two ago, made the point that the speech from the throne was dripping with good intent. And dripping with good intent it certainly was. But good intent is not what gets things done. Actually, what this opposition will be doing is we'll be holding the government to account, not for their good intention, because heaven forbid we agree with most, if not some of their good intention, but what we will be holding them to account for is the reality of their intention. And it's a situation where, now that they sit on the Treasury benches, actually deeds and actions speak louder than words and mere good intentions. And I want to just remind members opposite of the challenge that the Leader of the Opposition, Bill English, made in his speech. And he said that we're going to measure two important environmental measurements for this government. And this time next year, next Christmas, we'll be looking to the Avon River in Christchurch to see what tangible improvements in water quality have occurred there. And we'll be watching and we'll be wanting to report back. And similarly, the second area that we're going to be looking at this time next year is in Auckland City, where over the last 12 months or so, on 160 days, raw sewage has been pumped onto the beaches and into the harbour of Auckland in a way that if it was being done by farmers in our rural community, they would be prosecuted. So what we're going to do is ask this government to come good on their good intentions. Come good on their good intentions and prove that the road to purgatory is not paved with good intentions, and it's something more than that. Mr. Speaker, or Madam Speaker, David Parker has a very big workload. He's been given the environment responsibility. He's a capable member. I've had dealings with him from my time when I was chairing the Local Government Environment Select Committee, and I don't for one minute question his ability, but boy, he's got a very heavy workload. So we'll be watching that very closely over the next little period of time. Madam Speaker, the National Party is in incredibly good heart. We're united, we're strong, we're not at all diminished, and we will continue to ask questions, written, oral and policy questions of this government, holding them to account, holding the heat to their feet so that they actually have to turn good intentions into good deeds. Madam Speaker, I wish you well in your role as a presiding officer.
Madam Speaker.
Chris Fisher.
Well, thank you very much, Madam Assistant Speaker.